My talk is treatment endpoints for eosinophilic esophagitis, and what I'm hoping to do in the next few minutes is give you some very practical take-home data about how to take care of these patients, since this is a rapidly evolving area. What I'm going to say in the next few minutes is what definition you should now be using for eosinophilic esophagitis, talk about why to treat and what our treatment outcomes that we're looking for are, because that's a little bit confusing sometimes. When do you call this a success? I'm going to talk about treatment. I'm going to focus mostly on what we call the three D's, drug, diet, and dilation. And finally, speak a little bit to an area that's evolving now, but I think it's going to be very important, which is long-term treatment. It's become increasingly clear that eosinophilic esophagitis is a chronic disease, and treating it just intermittently may not make the most sense. Now, who should you say has EOE? There's a couple things that you need to know about this. Number one, 15 eosinophils does not equal EOE. Lots and lots of patients will have increased eosinophilia, and depending on the study that you look at, somewhere between one-third and two-thirds of those patients will not have EOE. So what do you need to make the diagnosis? Well, there have been multiple guidelines on this, and a consensus definition has emerged. You need symptoms related to esophageal dysfunction. Now, we talk an awful lot about dysphagia, and indeed, EOE is the number one cause of food impaction in many ERs now. But it doesn't have to be dysphagia. It turns out a substantial minority of these patients will have chest pain as a manifestation, will have other symptomatology, which may not remind you of EOE, but actually once you take the diagnosis and get farther in, as Phil mentioned, it is in the differential. On biopsy, we do use this number of 15. You say, well, what's so magical about 15? And that's a very reasonable question. We have looked to see how well the number correlates with symptomatology, and it does appear that once you start getting to 15, the likelihood of symptoms do go up. However, this is somewhat arbitrary. You want to see that eosinophilia is isolated to the esophagus. Well, why is that? Well, there are multiple entities throughout the GI tract that may have eosinophils in the esophagus, so you want to make sure that you're not dealing with eosinophilic gastroenteritis, a much rarer entity which requires different treatment. And finally, there's a raft of secondary causes of esophageal eosinophilia, things like infections as well as hypereosinophilic syndrome and even Crohn's disease that can show esophageal eosinophilia. Here's a classic biopsy for these patients. And in addition to asking what that count is, you want your pathologist to tell you other things. Are there degranulating eosinophils? Are there microabscesses? These things appear to increase the specificity of the diagnosis. How many biopsies do you need to take? This is a very pragmatic and important question. We generally biopsy 2 cups, one from the proximal, one from the distal esophagus, with 4 biopsies in both. There are multiple studies that have looked at this, and what you find, here's one of them, although there are other data out here like this, from the Northwestern group, and you can see that as you move up in the number of biopsies in this study, up to 5 biopsies, the likelihood that you're going to get a positive biopsy in a patient with eosinophilic esophagitis goes up substantially. So clearly, you should be taking at least 5. I think it's reasonable to go proximal and distal to see what the distribution of the eosinophils is, and also because this can be a very patchy entity and you don't want to take them all from the same place. Well, why are we going to treat this entity? Well, clearly in the short term, this is the first thing we notice, is that we could improve symptoms. You have patients who are having chest pain, who have reflux type symptoms, they will get better. Dysphagia will generally get better. Also, of course, we want to prevent complications. Here's somebody with a ringed esophagus, and this is not a dilation. This is just the passage of the endoscope. This mucosa is very friable. It splits very easily, and clearly you would like to avoid this kind of situation. And finally, and this is the least well described, to prevent progression. It's becoming clear in the literature now that untreated EOE will go on to a further narrowing of the esophagus. This is the same patient at our place from 2008, and there they are in 2015. You get some idea that they may have a little more mucosal pallor here, but what you really don't get an idea of until I show you this next one is how narrow they are. That's the tip of a savory wire. This is a patient that we could pass the adult scope on in 2008. Here they are in 2015. So you've made the diagnosis, you're going to treat now. Well, the question is, what is the treatment outcome you're shooting for? And if you don't know what you're aiming for, it's hard to know if you've hit it. Well, there are lots of possible treatment outcomes you can treat to. Clearly, the one that we think about most and most commonly is histology. We look at those counts to see those counts go down. Do the counts need to go down to zero? No. It's pretty clear that even if you're getting below five, there's a good likelihood you're going to get substantial improvement. But to be honest with you, probably the least important thing to your patient is what their eosinophil count is. They want to know, what are my symptoms doing? What's my quality of life? So asking these questions, are they having complications? Do they require endoscopy? These are really important outcome measures as well. In fact, more important to the patient. And in fact, you've got a growing field now trying to understand what's the area that we should be tracking. The problems with our outcomes are they're not well defined. What number should I shoot for with those eosinophils? They're not standardized in the literature. Some papers will say, oh, well, less than five is a success. Some will say zero is a success. Some will say, well, the patient has to have no dysphagia. That's a success. And there's a substantial possibility of discordance. What I mean by that is that your counts can look great, and the patient can still be having problems with dysphagia. In that situation, you see the symptoms improve, but you see the inflammation improve, but the symptoms persist. Also, you can see just the opposite. The symptoms improve, but the inflammation persists. How should we look at that? For these reasons, we've been trying to get validated outcomes in patients. And what you can see here is a raft of papers. We don't have a consensus quality index for these patients, a patient-reported outcome measure. But you can see that there's a bunch of people that are working on this now. And my guess is that we're going to end up having a good assessment tool that we're all going to be using in a little bit, although right now there are multiple of these around, and there's clearly not a consensus yet. I'm going to talk a little bit now about treatment options in EOE, and you can see here I've got on this list of a wide variety of treatment options that have been tried. Because of time, and also because many of these are not commonly used, I'm not going to go in depth in most of them. However, I am going to touch on some of the most important ones and talk very specifically about how you can use them in your practice. I will point out to you that there is no FDA-approved medication for EOE. We're retrofitting all of this stuff to our patients without an FDA-approved medication, and for that reason, they all have shortcomings. The ones I highlight in this slide are the ones that I'm going to go over. I'm going to speak to corticosteroid use fairly extensively because that's what many of us are using now. I'm going to touch on the biologics. I'm going to talk a little bit about new directions in pharmacologic therapy. I'm going to speak about dietary therapy, a therapy that is not well used amongst adults, but perhaps should be more. And finally, I'm going to talk about endoscopy and endoscopic dilatation because many people have great concerns about treating their patients with dilation. Let's start with corticosteroids. This slide is a composite slide that shows the randomized controlled trials of topical steroids in eosinophilic esophagitis. And what you see on this slide is on this axis you see the eosinophil count both before and after treatment. And what you see here is the name of the first author, the year it was published, and some other details, randomized controlled trial, the number of people. You can see that many of these studies are in children. But a consistent finding in all these studies is a remarkable drop an eosinophil count with this treatment. And that seems to occur whether you use the swallowed inhaler, the fluticasone, shown here by the inhaler, whether you use budesonide, shown here by the little capsule, or whether you use budesonide combined with Splenda so that you get a slurry that the patients drink. No matter what you use, you get a remarkable decrease in eosinophil counts. So how should you be using corticosteroids? Well, you have a couple choices here, as I've just shown you. You've got the swallowed inhaler. This is 220, 4 puffs BID. Make sure you know the weight, how much the inhaler is giving off, because not all inhalers give off the exact same number of micrograms. Or you could use budesonide, 1 milligram BID, mixed with a thickening agent. Some people use honey. Some people use Splenda. Doesn't really much matter. The idea here is that you want it to sit and coat the esophagus so that it has some dwell time in the esophagus. Of these two, actually, I think budesonide is probably a little bit more effective based on some marker studies that we did to see where the drug actually goes. The fluticasone goes all over. It ends up in their lungs. It ends up in their mouth. The budesonide is a little bit more localized. However, whichever one you use, you're going to get, generally speaking, good results. If you're going to use the metered dose inhaler, You swallow the medication during a breath hold. Unfortunately, because many of these patients have a relative with asthma, unless you really do a good job of coaching them, no, 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 we're using this for a different reason, they'll take it into their lungs. They'll take it on an inhalation. They want to be NPO for 30 to 60 minutes after the administration and 8 weeks of treatment followed by an endoscopy. And I would highly encourage you, you know, this disease gets a little bit tedious for the patient because they need a lot of endoscopies, but I would highly encourage you to bring your patients back in to monitor their response to therapy. Although this has been worked out empirically, there's a lot we don't know about these treatments. For instance, what's the best duration of therapy? We tend to use 8 weeks. Could less or more be more effective? What's the best type of topical preparation? I've already mentioned that there's a little bit of comparative data, but not nearly what we'd need to know. Why does it not work when it doesn't work? What's going on in the steroid refractory cases? And of course, the long-term side effects. Certainly the short to mid-term side effects seem acceptable. You do get some candidiasis in the esophagus, but otherwise it seems to be fairly well tolerated. So moving on now, I'm going to speak for just a couple seconds about biologics, because this is an area that's evolving and I think you're going to hear more about. There's an awful lot of study going on the biologics now. I point out a couple of them here. These are both interleukins, interleukin 5 and interleukin 13, that have been found to be very instrumental in the pathogenesis of EOE. If you take an animal and fuse them with interleukin 13, they develop esophageal eosinophilia. If you take a patient with EOE and you titer their interleukin 13 in their esophagus, they have a much higher titer of interleukin 13 than a normal. Clearly, these make for attractive potential targets. Here's a little bit of data on this, a recent study about an anti-interleukin 13 monoclonal antibody. And you can see here, this is the, it's a small study, 15 and 8. This is done by Mark Rothenberg's group. And you can see that the placebo group, as you might expect, the peak in eosinophil count bounces around at baseline, day 85, and end of study, as opposed to the patients that got the monoclonal antibody who got a remarkable drop in their eosinophil count. Is this what we're going to be using? I'm not sure. But I do think that we're going to have more sophisticated and probably more disease-directed therapy for eosinophilic esophagitis. I want to say a couple words now about dietary therapy. Dietary therapy does not give much love amongst adult gastroenterologists compared to our peers in pediatrics. And I want to show you some data because I think that it probably deserves your attention, certainly as good second-line therapy if your steroids fail, and probably in at least some motivated patients as primary therapy. And I put a question mark here. This may be the best therapy for some patients, and we don't talk about it much. It's pretty clear that food allergens contribute to the pathogenesis of EOE just based on the results of elimination diets. Now, of course, we've got problems with this. We don't know really what the offending entity or entities is for most patients. There's difficulties with dietary compliance, although we seem to be just fine with torturing our children with it. Adults will not do this. There are three overall strategies that I'm going to mention briefly. If you can get people to take it, an elemental diet, which they have to drink and doesn't taste very good, a six-food elimination diet, which you'll see in the slides as SFED, and some more targeted elimination, meaning smaller eliminations that may still be effective. And I show some of the primary offenders over here, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. This is a nice meta-analysis that was in Gastro last year, and you can see here, essentially it asks the question, how effective are these various dietary interventions in patients with eosinophilic esophagitis? And it's just what you might think it would be based on how hard it is to comply with the diet. Studies of elemental diets generally show 91% of patients improve based on a variety of outcome measures. Six-food elimination diets, 72% improve. And more targeted, more slimmed-down eliminations are a little bit more variable, with 46% improving. So let's talk for a second about elemental diets. Here's a nice study, I think it was out of Utah, 29 patients enrolled. Interestingly, 11 could not adhere to the diet. However, amongst those that could adhere, the 18 and 72%, they did get a histologic response, dropping down to less than 10 EOs per high-powered field. And the mean eosinophil count dropped from 54 to 10. They also had an improvement in their endoscopic findings with the exception of fixed fibrotic strictures. And 6 subjects who had food introduction had recurrent eosinophilia within 2 to 7 days. And this is a recurrent finding in these dietary studies. When you reintroduce the offending agent, very quickly they'll get an increase in their eosinophils, and not long after that they'll get symptomatology. How about the 6 food elimination diet? This is the study from the Northwestern group that really made this a little more popular and on our radar. This was 50 patients who eliminated milk, soy, egg, wheat, nuts, and seafood for 6 weeks. So a pretty darn restrictive diet when you look at that. Probably be a hard diet to follow. Interestingly though, 64% had their eosinophil count drop to less than 5. A remarkable response that is in line with or better than that seen in patients who are taking steroid. 94% had improved symptom scores. And then they did a relatively complex reintroduction of foods in 20 of them. If you do hit your offending agent, the mean time to recurrence was 3 days. And in this study, wheat and milk were the most common allergens. And I will say that in other studies of this, wheat and milk are very often implicated as the primary ones. And if you're going to drop out one, as I'll show you in a second, many people will drop out milk with good success. I want to make this point because there's a lot of confusion about should these patients see allergists, how should we handle the testing. Unfortunately, skin prick testing is not very useful in these patients. It's neither sensitive nor specific, and in fact, in this study, only 13% of causal agents were found by skin prick testing. Well, clearly that works well, but that's an awful hard diet to follow. Are there possibilities for less restrictive options? Well, you could use a 4-food elimination diet. Here's a study that eliminated dairy, wheat, eggs, and nuts, and 54% of these patients in the smaller slim-down study had response defined as less than 15 EOs per high-powered field. There have been other studies that have used a less restrictive diet. Again, dairy, wheat, egg, and soy seem to be the ones that are favored in terms of eliminating them. And you can see 46% in Northwestern study, 71% using a cutoff of less than 15 at DDW earlier this year. And how about this, a 1-food elimination diet? Well, 2 studies here, both looking at eliminating cow's milk. And again, smaller, but substantial response rates, defined as less than 15 EOs per high power field, 65% in this study, 64% in that study. So could there come a time when you say, well, let's start just by eliminating cow's milk. Let's see what that does for you, because boy, that's something that most people could do. We're not quite there yet, but it's an interesting thought. It's clear that dietary therapy works. Unfortunately, it can be hard for patients. It's also resource and time intensive if you are following this up with endoscopy to see if patients are responding. A multidisciplinary approach is key, and it's helpful to have a nutritionist with these patients so you tell them what they can eat. And there are ongoing questions about, wouldn't it be nice to have better testing to know what food really causes problems? What's the best approach to adding back foods when you've gotten a response after a very restrictive diet? And will one of these less restrictive diets work? I want to end up by saying a couple words about dilation therapy, mostly to reassure you and assuage you. Here's a patient that had a nice response, and you say, boy, you call that nice. You actually do want mucosal disruption to a balloon dilation. Here's a savory, can do the same thing, and which one to use is not entirely clear. There are good responses in the literature reported with each. Now, the early literature on dilation of EOE gave people cause for concern. There were quite a few patients that needed to be hospitalized. There was some report of perforation in these early studies. And there was a time when we said, well, be careful. Maybe you don't want to dilate these patients. However, larger, more recent series suggest that you can get good responses without a lot of perforation. You can see here in these much larger studies that while there certainly were some problems, these patients in general had a pretty good safety profile. So I think you can feel comfortable dilating these patients. What do the patients tell you about that? Well, they clearly have a relatively prolonged improvement of their dysphagia. They'll tell you, 3/4 of them will tell you that they got pain, and these patients do hurt more. And all the patients would have repeated it again, although 19% thought it was very cumbersome. So there are no direct comparative data on technique. The safety data that are published for both balloons and bougies, as I said, you can use either. You need to let the patients know they're going to hurt and take, I would say, a cautious approach. Here's a patient who had a balloon, had a nice rip after that. Same thing could happen with savories, and you do get this big mucosal disruption. I'm going to end up by saying a couple words about long-term treatment. This is a chronic disease, and the symptoms and findings and inflammation recur after treatment. Therefore, maintenance therapy may make sense, and we're in our early days of this. You should at least consider maintenance therapy for rapid symptom recurrence or complications such as stricture or food impaction. This maintenance therapy is usually 1/2 to 1/4 of the initial therapy. So I'm going to show you the summary algorithm, which is in your slides. If you have a new diagnosis of EOE and they've got a very tight stricture, I would go ahead and dilate it. Then you either do topical steroids or dietary elimination. If they have a response, you consider maintenance therapy. If they're non-responsive and they have a tight stricture, you can dilate them. If they don't, then it's kind of the Wild West. But there's one box that I would definitely point out to you is to consider trying the other thing you didn't try up here. If you started with steroids, switch to diet. If you start with diet, you switch to steroids. After that, we don't really know about these therapies which one is going to be best. Thank you for your attention.